Amen. Well, that'll get your blood pumping. Hopefully you hear God singing to you this morning. Amen. Great to be together. Feels like I've seen some of you guys a lot at camp and other things, and then some of you guys I feel like I haven't seen. I know Tioms are back from Africa, so good to have you guys home. 27-hour flight or travel? 27. Sounds like a good time. Anyway, I hope your summer is off to a great start. You know, some of our families, as was mentioned, are off in St. Louis doing the Youth and Family Weekend. Of course, camp is come and gone. Vacations are on. The heat is on. Not in the building, but, you know, outside. But it's summertime, amen? I did want to let you guys know about something. Many of you know this already, but if you didn't, the Werners, they've been here 7 years now, hard to believe, since they were just toddlers, basically. But they've been serving faithfully in our campus ministry, and one of the things in the church that we've done for our ministry staff is to offer sabbaticals. And so after 7 years, we're sending them on a one-month sabbatical just to get some time to rest, to kind of unplug, to spend time with one another, spend time with God, and to come back and serve our campus ministry in an even greater way. So you won't see the Werners for about a month. If you need anything regarding campus ministry, you can talk to AJ. If you need other things that maybe you would go to Josh and Katie about, you can come to us. I know Amanda's taking care of the bulletin while Katie's gone. If it's a really serious issue, talk to AJ. If you have complaints, talk to AJ. If you need stuff done around your house, talk to... No. AJ's our intern for the summer, so we got to put him to work, amen? All right, we're going to jump right into our lesson this morning, and it's called How to Get Along with Anyone. How to Get Along with Anyone. And there's a little thing in there, we'll talk about that later. But basically, we're talking about how to get along with anyone. You know, our world has a problem getting along with others. I don't know if you've noticed that, but I've noticed that, right? Sometimes I have a problem getting along with others. Perhaps you have a problem getting along with others. And so it's nothing new, right? From the beginning, Satan has been trying to divide us. From the very beginning, in the garden, God says, hey, don't eat from that tree. And what does Satan say? Did God really say don't eat from that tree? From the very start. And then Adam, when he does it, you know, he messes up. Eve gets him to do it. They do it together. And he says, oh, it's this woman. He blames her, right? And he says, it's this woman that you put here with me. So there's only three people involved, and they're all already at odds with one another. But it's going to get better, right? Because then they have kids, Cain and Abel. You know that story. That didn't end well. So from the beginning, we've seen man turn against God. We've seen man turn against woman, brother against brother. I mean, it just goes on and on. Satan himself, the whole problem is his disunity with God. He opposed God and was thrown down. There's something in our sinful natures that wants to fight. There's something in our sinful natures that wants to always be right. Something that we want to get our way. We want to prove our point to the world. You remember even going back to elementary school, you remember this on your report card? You got listens carefully, follows direction, does work neatly, plays well with others, right? Anybody ever get an unsatisfactory, get a U on that? You know, maybe right now some of us are getting a U and plays well with others. But, you know, I dug into this, I found this report card online. I dug into the person that this is referring to, and it's actually Jim Scott. See Jimmy Scott there? That was his fifth grade picture, I believe. Anyways, we have a problem. We have a get-along problem. Maybe some of you parents, or maybe this was done to you as a kid. You ever see the get-along shirts when your kids aren't getting along and you get like an oversized shirt and you stick them both in there and they don't get to come out of that shirt until they get along, right? Maybe some of us need a get-along shirt this morning. Hopefully not. You know, think about social media, right? Social with a question mark there, media. We have a get-along problem. Social media, I think, has brought out the worst in some. There's an anonymity that comes with that. It's not face-to-face interactions. People say things that they would never say in person. In fact, there's a term, a new term, it's called online disinhibition effect. The online disinhibition effect. It refers to the lack of restraint one feels when communicating online in comparison to communicating in person. People tend to feel safer saying things online that they would not say in real life because they have the ability to remain completely anonymous and invisible on particular websites. As a result, free from potential consequences. Apart from anonymity, other factors such as asynchronous communication, empathy deficit, or individual personality and cultural factors also contribute to online disinhibition. You know, whether we like it or not, social media is here to stay, right? We're not putting that genie back in the bottle. And for most of us, maybe all of us, but it's part of our social interactions, right? I would guess probably 90 to 95% of the church in some way, shape, or form uses online communication. Therefore, we must treat it as we would any other social interactions. We can't say, well, I've got this online persona, but this is the real me. No, that is the real us. All the principles you would use in interacting with others face-to-face, at your job, at school, in the fellowship, we must apply those to social media as well. We don't get a pass to mistreat others because it's virtual. There was a show that came out a few years ago called The Social Dilemma. Anybody seen The Social Dilemma? If you haven't seen it, I would highly encourage you to see it, especially if you have kids, because it's really going to help. But in this, basically one of the things they point out is that the algorithms that are on our in the internet, on our computers, they're designed to give you more of what you want. So if you like the Razorbacks, you're going to see a lot more of the Razorback stuff. I don't get a lot of like Kentucky Wildcat stuff on my feed. I get the Razorbacks because that's what I'm interested in. And so that can lead to even more division in our society because if you like this thing or you like this thing, you're getting a lot of that and you're not getting this. And if you lean a certain way, you're going to get lean that way more. And so this whole premise of the social dilemma is while they designed this, I think, to give us what we were interested in, it divided us even more. You know, in almost every discussion online, someone is going to disagree with someone else. You just go on to the Channel 5 News, go on to any site you want, and someone will pick a fight. Someone will disprove something that someone else is saying. So I wanted to see how true this was. So I searched, the sky is blue. And you know what popped up? One of the first things, according to the BBC, it's actually bluish purple. It's like, the sky is blue. No, it's not. It's bluish purple. And they said, technically, the short wavelengths that scatter across the sky correspond to the colors blue and violet, but we don't see violet as well, so we see the sky as blue. So next time somebody says sky is blue, say, nope, it's bluish purple. We will find any reason to argue, to disagree, to not get along. And, you know, some are more serious than others, but some are inconsequential, right? I think about people disagree on sports teams, right? I mean, there you have Arkansas versus LSU. That, to me, there's no question, right? But I guarantee you there are people that feel different. Or not even the team. We disagree on the conference, right? No, it's SEC is better than the Big Ten. And you'll see online debates about which is better, and people will get really mad about this. Or this one, this is pretty serious, round earth versus flat earth, right? I don't know. Maybe there's some in here that feel the earth is round. Who knows, you know? Or how about this one? Did we go to the moon? You know, is this some studio in the desert? Or did we go to the moon? We're not getting into it right now, okay? Some of you guys are getting, like, stirred up. I can tell. Or here's this is really serious, okay? Brace yourself for this one. Swifties versus the Bayhive. They will come to blows about this, right? Swifties versus the Bayhive. But the point is, we have a get-along problem. Today we're going to be talking about, the next few weeks we're going to be talking about how to get along with anyone. And we'll get to the just about in a little bit. But for right now, we're just talking about how to get along with anyone. You know, a few weeks ago we even talked about the election, and not the national election, but rather our election, right? Our election as disciples of Jesus, we are God's elect, chosen by him. But there is that other thing, that other election that's going on. And as we enter into this season, I think it's important to talk about how do we talk to one another? How do we interact with one another? How can we get along in a world and in a country that is becoming so divided? You know, you think about the history of the world, the wars that have happened throughout history. Currently, there are over 110 armed conflicts in the world. Think about that, 110 armed conflicts going. We hear about some of them a lot, right? But there's other ones we don't even know are happening. We have a get-along problem. There's estimates that throughout history, between 150 million and 1 billion people have been killed in wars. Maybe a billion people killed in wars. Almost 500,000 people are killed by homicide each year worldwide. We've got a get-along problem in our world. No society or culture is immune. You know, maybe some seemingly do better at times, but if you just look at the span of history, man, every society, every culture has been affected by the get-along problem. And I believe that it's going to happen until Jesus comes back. I don't think we're ever really going to get there. The world will not get there. And Christians are not immune either. Christians are not immune to the get-along problems. And I think sometimes we have this idea that the church will be free from problems. That the church will be free from disagreements. That we'll be free from sin because it's the church, right? And it's not. Well, I disagree. No. You know, if you look at the Bible, many and most of the New Testament books, they were written, why? To deal with conflict in the church. I mean, there's some encouragement in there. There's some good teaching. But a lot of it was, hey, you guys are having a problem. Here's how you need to work it out. You see examples like Euodia and Syntyche in the book of Philippians. Paul says he pleaded with them to be of the same mind. In Acts 15, Paul and Barnabas, they were in sharp dispute because these people came into town teaching circumcision. So they got into this dispute. And then later in the same chapter, Paul and Barnabas get in a fight. And they go separate ways. So no one is immune to the get-along problem. 2 Timothy 4, Paul talks about Alexander the metalworker did him a great deal of harm. In 3 John, there's this guy named Diotrephes, and John says, hey, nothing to do with that guy, right? So even in the church, we can have get-along issues. And if you think about it, it's not surprising. Some of us may not have grown up in environments that we learn how to communicate, that we learn how to deal with conflict. Perhaps our home growing up was filled with strife and division. Some of us may come from broken homes. Some of us have been in bad relationships. Some have been abused or maybe been the abusive. We may not have had good examples of how to work out our problems and differences in a godly way. And you know what? When we become disciples, we bring all that baggage with us, right? Now, we're forgiven of our past. We're not keeping that burden on our backs, but there's still things in our character. There's things in our nature that can bubble up at times, even in the church. We still have areas that we need to continue to repent and grow in. Jesus knew this would be a challenge. In fact, he prayed towards the end of his life. One of the things he prayed for was our unity. John 17 and verse 20, he says, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message." That's us. "That all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me. So that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me." Man, Jesus wanted us to be unified. He says complete unity. No division. In fact, he says to be unified as he and the Father were unified. Just as he and the Father were one, that's the call for us as the body of Christ, is to be completely unified. And there's a lot riding on it. He says, this is how the world will know that you sent me. You know, in John 13, 34, he says, "By this all men will know you're my disciples, by your love." As God's people, how are we doing? Yeah, I read a statistic that said there's over 45,000 Christian denominations in the world. Think about that, 45,000. That's not people, that's denominations of people. This one thing that Jesus prayed for, well, he prayed for many, but in this instance, was for our unity, and there's 45,000 different groups of us on the planet. You know, when I read that, I got super emotional. I was like, man, how are we doing as God's people? Let's pray right now. God, thank you so much for today. Thank you that we can come together and worship you. And God, I feel unity in this room. God, I feel the love for one another. And yet our world is so divided. And even in the church, in the body of Christ, there's so much disagreement, division, just different things going on at times. And God, we just want to apologize to you. We want to repent. If in any way we contribute to that, God, we want to change that. We want to grow. We want to be unified with you, and we want to be unified with one another, God. We want to get along in this world. And God, we just pray that you give us an extra measure of your spirit. God, that you give us an extra dose of perseverance and patience and kindness and goodness with one another. We love you. Thank you that Jesus prayed for our unity, and I pray that we can continue that prayer today and through the rest of our lives. We pray this in your son's name. Amen. Thousands of denominations just in Christianity, and then you add in every other religion. You add in all the belief systems. You know, even people that aren't religious, it's still religion. The definition of religion simply means a system of beliefs. So you could totally not believe anything about a deity, and you're still religious about what you believe in. But they say worldwide there's 10,000 different religions. So you got 45,000 different Christian denominations, and then you have 10,000 other religions out there. We have a get-along problem. And so in the next few sermons, we're going to fix all of this. No, we're not going to do that. That would be awesome. But we're going to, you know what we can do? We can look at ourselves. I can look at me. You can look at you. And in fact, that's the next thing I want to talk about here is that this lesson is for you. This lesson is for me. And so as we start to talk about these things, don't fall into this trap of thinking, yep, this is really good for so-and-so. Man, I hope AJ hears this. He hadn't been doing, you know, what he's supposed to be. I hope AJ gets it, you know. No, don't worry about AJ right now, all right? AJ needs to worry about AJ. You need to worry about you, and I need to worry about me, amen? In fact, Jesus talked about this. Matthew 7, verse 3 says, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there's a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. And of course, this is true about any topic, right? We first need to examine ourselves and say, hey, where do I need to grow in this area? Where do I fall short in this area? You know, I've been thinking about this lesson for quite a while, and as I started digging into the scriptures, it got really overwhelming, because there's actually a lot of scriptures that talk about the topics that we're going to be talking about getting along, about how we interact with one another, about taming the tongue, about, you know, there's so much, and so we're not going to be able to cover every scripture in there, but what I am going to do is I'm going to put together a list of scriptures that deal with these issues, and I'm going to get it out to you guys in the church. And so if you want to have a quiet time on this in addition to the lessons we're doing, I think it'd be really helpful, and you can learn even more about it. So today I want to let the Bible speak to us. We're going to look at some scriptures that can really help us. And so you might ask, so how can we get along with anyone? If the world is so divided, if the world has always been divided, what's the use? What's the point? Why are we even talking about this? And fortunately, what we do have is the Word of God. We have some very specific instructions on how to get along with anyone. Commands, direction on how to get along. It's almost like God knew we were going to struggle with this. It was like, hey, I'm going to give you guys plenty of resources here to deal with this. And so today, we're going to cover part one of how to get along with anyone, and that's how to avoid conflict, all right? The best way to get along with somebody is just not to have a conflict in the first place. Now, I'll just say this. I know some of us are the peacemaker, you know, we're ready to jump into conflict. We're going to get to that, okay? So just relax. We'll get to that too. But right now, we're just talking about how to avoid conflict. The best way to get along with anyone is to not have the conflict in the beginning. And the first point that we have with this, and you might have heard your grandma tell you this, it's mind your business. How do you avoid conflict? Mind your business, right? Newsflash, you nor I can fix all the world's get-along problems, but we can stop contributing to it, right? We can't fix every problem that's out there, but we don't have to be a part of it. And not all conflict is bad, right? There's times when conflict is necessary, but certainly not all conflict is good. And sometimes the best way to get along is just to mind your business. There's some popular phrases that you might have heard about, not your circus, not your monkeys, right? That's not your monkeys, don't worry about them. That's somebody else's monkeys. They'll take care of those. That's not your circus. Stay out of it. Or not your chili, so don't stir the pot, right? That's somebody else's chili. You don't need to be stirring the pot in somebody else's chili. So to help us understand maybe, okay, what should I be getting involved in? What should I not get involved in? I have this, and you guys, some of you have seen this before. It's called the circle of concern. You seen this? There's the circle of concern, the circle of influence, and the circle of control. Circle of concern are things that are completely outside of my control. I may have concerns about those. I might worry about those or think about those, but I have no control whatsoever. That would be, you know, the church worldwide, right? I mean, we can control or have influence here in our local congregation, but something that happens in, you know, whatever country, I can't do much about that. But I am concerned. I can pray about that. Other denominations of Christianity, I can't control that. I can't do anything about that. Politics, you know, just world events. Sometimes those are in our circle of concern, but we have no influence or control. Then you have the circle of influence, right? These are things I can influence. I can't control them, but I can have an influence. I can have an impact on these things. That might be those in your family, close friends, the local church right here, right? Your family group, your job place. You know, there's things you can have an influence on. And then you have the circle of control, things I can control. And let me just say, it's pretty much just you. That's pretty much, I mean, when your kids are little, right, when they're 5 and 6, you can kind of control them. But even then, it's like, well, I can't control everything, right? As they get older, you have no control, right? Now, you still have influence. You can still influence your kids. You know, Bretha, Derek, you can still influence AJ, but you have no control over that young man, right? Just, AJ, just brace yourself. It's going to be all summer, bro. I'm just going to be, like, bringing it to you. So what I have noticed is that some of us, self-included at times, we want to fix things that are completely out of our control. We want to control what is out of our control. We worry about what is out of our control, and it leads to a lot of worry. It leads to anxiety. It leads to conflict that sometimes we jump into that we have no business jumping into. There are things in this world, believe it or not, that you have no power, no influence, and no control over. There's one thing you can do, which is incredibly powerful, and that's pray. When you are tempted to not mind your business, pray. That's not my business. I can't do anything about that. I have no influence. I have no control. Let me just pray. Let me don't jump into something that I don't need to be jumping into. Sometimes you just have to mind your business. You know, the scriptures speak to this. Don't just take my word for it. Let's see what God said. Proverbs 26:17. Like one who grabs a stray dog by the ears is someone who rushes into a quarrel not their own. We've got some dog people in here, right? Got dog trainer. Clint back there is a dog trainer. And imagine just going up to some stray wild dog and grabbing it by the ears. That's not going to go well for you. But God says that's what it's like if you jump into a quarrel that's not your own. In other words, let me translate it for you. God says, mind your business. Proverbs 20, verse 3. It is to one's honor to avoid strife, but every fool is quick to quarrel. Man, God says if you're quick to jump into a quarrel, you're a fool. Not my words, his word. You don't like it? Take it up with God. And let me tell you, that's out of your control as well, whatever he says, all right? So do what you want with that. And I'm not saying there's not a time to get involved. We'll talk about that. You know, Jesus stood up for those that couldn't stand up for themselves. But getting involved in every conflict or quarrel that we encounter, it's just foolish. And again, for some of us, maybe we're peacemakers by nature, and so we feel this pull to want to get involved and want to help, and we think we're going to help, but really, if it's out of our control and it's not our business, we can do more harm to ourselves and to others. You know, another scripture, Ecclesiastes 7:9 says, "Do not be quickly provoked in your spirit, for anger resides in the laps of fools." Man, are you quickly provoked in your spirit? You know, you see something happen, and maybe it's to a friend or a loved one, or maybe it's just something that happens in the world, and you're just quickly provoked. It's like, man, that gets me going. I got to say something. I got to do something. And God says anger resides in the laps of fools. Imagine how much more that people might get along if everybody would just mind their business, right? And again, I'm not talking, there's things we need to be involved in, whatever. We're not saying 100%, but we're just saying in general. You know, when your friends on social media post things that you completely disagree with, maybe try to just mind your business. When you see a news article about things happening in some part of the world and it's out of your circle of control, you pray, but maybe we need to mind our business. When you see other people engaged in some disagreement that has nothing to do with you, do you want to get involved, or maybe we can mind our business? And let me say this too. Some of us like a good fight, right? Maybe that's your nature. Maybe in your household growing up, I mean, you got into everything. Your parents and you and your siblings and a good argument, a good conflict. And again, I'm not saying there's never a time and place. But even when we do that, and we'll talk more about this next week, we got to do it with love, with patience, with kindness, with wisdom. But in general, if you can avoid a conflict, do so. Mind your business. Now, my next point kind of goes hand in hand with this first point. Sometimes we do mind our own business, right? But maybe someone directs something more toward us, right? And now they're trying to egg us in, or egg us on, draw us into some kind of conflict, right? And so, well, now they're getting personal. Now it's coming at me. And, you know, if we're close to that person, it's somebody here in the local church or in our family, maybe we need to work that out. But other times, in the words of one princess, Disney princess, maybe we need to let it go, right? I minded my business, but they brought it right to me, and now I got to get in the conflict. But maybe, just maybe, we got to let it go. I'm not going to sing it. AJ is. No, he's sometimes you just got to let it go. I promise you this. If you want to find faults in someone, you will. If you want to be offended, you'll find a way. One of the problems I think in our world today, in social media especially, is people are so easily offended by things that have nothing to do with them. And I get it. Things offend me at times, but sometimes I just gotta let it go. We jump into arguments and discussions that we'd be better off just leaving alone. In fact, Proverbs 12 talks about this. It says, "The way of fools seems right to them, but the wise listen to advice." Listen to this. "Fools show their annoyance at once, but the prudent overlook an insult." How do you respond when someone insults you? When someone says or does something that you don't like or you disagree with, are you quick to rush into that? You show your annoyance at once? Or he says the prudent, which is the wise, the judicious, it says they overlook an insult. They let it go. Proverbs 19, verse 11 says, "A person's wisdom yields patience. It is to one's glory to overlook an offense." Do you think about being offended in that way? Or do you feel like, man, I'm going to defend myself. I'm going to fight. I'm ready to go. Or when you're offended, do you say, you know what? I'm going to get some glory here. I'm going to overlook that offense because that's to my glory. That's to God's glory. Now, that doesn't mean in our marriage we don't deal with problems and, you know, all different things. But even in our marriages, sometimes you got to overlook an offense, right? Your husband or wife, they do something that they shouldn't have done. And if every single time they do something wrong, you're on them about it, it's not going to go well for you. It's to one's glory to overlook an offense. Ask yourself, are you easily annoyed? Every little thing that you disagree with or it comes your way or someone says to you, is it like, man, you're on? People are going to hurt your feelings. People are going to annoy you. People are going to disagree with you. People are going to say things you don't like. And as our society seems to be more and more easily offended and easily angered, as Christians, God says sometimes you got to let it go. Overlook an offense. He says, the way of a fool seems right, but the wise listen to advice. You know, if you do need to engage, or you feel like, hey, this is one, I can't just let this go, I'm going to have to get engaged, I'd say, hey, go get some advice about it before you do it. The Bible has a lot to say about that. Before you wage war, seek advice, right? And so instead of just jumping headfirst into some kind of conflict, go seek some advice about it. Hey, is this something I should just let it go? Or is this something I need to engage in? Seek some advice. Don't be a fool and show your annoyance at once. You know, maybe you can utilize this tactic. You guys know this, but it's the 10-second tactic, right? Someone says something that's offensive or whatever, and you're ready to go, but just stop and count to 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe pray as you go in between the numbers, whatever you need to do, you know. And let me say this, pro tip, don't do that out loud like in a work meeting, okay? Like so your boss says something, you're like, 1, 2, 3, don't do that, right? That's out of context. But silently to yourself, you know, you just take a breath, take a pause, okay? Proverbs 26 says this, do not answer a fool according to his folly, or you yourself will be just like him, right? Sometimes we're dealing with fools, right? God says it, not me. He says, don't answer a fool according to his folly, or you will be just like him. Now, you might say, yeah, but the next part says, answer a fool according to his folly, or he'll be wise in his own eyes. So I'm doing that one, right? You got to have wisdom here. How do you discern? Because both of these can be true, right? If your child is just doing something foolish or says something foolish, that might be a time to engage and answer that fool according to his own folly. But if it's just some random person or your boss or your, you know, like don't engage in that way. Or you will be just like the person that you feel is offending you. Proverbs 26 and verse 20 says, without wood, a fire goes out. Without a gossip, a quarrel dies down. As charcoal to embers and as wood to fire, so is a quarrelsome person for kindling strife. The words of a gossip are like choice morsels. They go down to the inmost parts. You know, sometimes you just got to stop putting wood on the fire. Without wood, a fire goes out. Just let it burn itself out at times. A quarrelsome person, they say, is kindling strife. You're just putting fuel on the fire because you got to get the last word. You know, I had one of my best friends growing up, and I was probably like this with him, but he always had to get the last word in. I mean, even if he just said, yep. Like, he had to get the last word. You're like, yeah, but you did that, you know, like, and it was just like this nonstop. And at one point, you just got to be like, I'm not going to put any more wood on this fire. We would even wrestle. And like, if you ever got him held down, he'd be like, okay, I'm going to stop now. I'm like, no, now you're not going to stop. I got you, you know. Or if I was getting out of the hold, he'd be like, I'm going to let you up now. No, you're not letting me do anything. I'm getting up, right? And it was just this back and forth. And I'd put a log on, he'd put a log on, I'd put a log on. You just got to stop putting wood on the fire. So, I think this would be a good time to bring up, you know, our sermon today is how to get along with anyone, right? And there's a little just about there. So now we're going to talk about how to get along with just about anyone, right? Not everyone wants to get along. Sometimes there will be people in this world that no matter what you do or say, no matter if you do everything right, no matter if you're the most humble person in the world, anybody in here the most humble person in the world? Okay, even if you were, you're not going to get along with everybody. And that's why I put that little caveat in there, because I don't want us to feel like if we don't get along somehow, you know, there's just people that you're not going to be able to get along with. Even Jesus experienced this. Was Jesus humble? Did Jesus sin? Did Jesus do everything right? Yeah. And yet, some people did not like Jesus. Some people mistreated Jesus. They even killed Jesus. So for us who are not Jesus, to think that we're not going to have some people that we just cannot get along with. It would be foolish, right? You know, Luke 4, at one point, Jesus, the crowd got so mad at him in Luke 4, they were about to throw him off a cliff. And you know what he did? He walked away. He says he walked right through the, I don't know how he did it. I don't know if there was like a force field, you know, or whatever. He's just, you know, people clear. But he walked away. He just left it alone. And I just want to say this as we talk about let it go. This is not about a close friend or a brother or sister in the church or a close family member. But there might be people in this world that the only thing you can do is to just walk away. You're not going to get along with them. It's not worth trying to do that over and over and over. And again, that's like a last resort kind of thing. But sometimes you just got to walk away. And that leads me to our last point. Because for some of us, that's hard. Hard to walk away, right? Because they wronged me. They hurt me. They didn't repent. They didn't do this. And you know what we can do is let God deal with it. Right? Not saying he's going to strike lightning on him or whatever. Don't pray for that for your enemy, right? But sometimes you just got to let God deal with it. Because you know what? It's hard to mind your business. It's hard to let it go. But we also know God will deal with things. There's a verse in the song we sing, Hard Fighting Soldier, that says, Jesus is my captain, and he fights my battle still. He has never lost a battle, and I know he never will. Do you believe that? We sing it. Or do you feel like, well, Jesus is my captain, but I got to fight this battle? Because he might not do it the way I would have done it. He might not have the outcome I want. No, Jesus has got you. And we see this example even in Jesus. We see Jesus at times, he let God deal with it. In Isaiah 53, verse 7, it says, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before the shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. We know Jesus said, you don't think I could call 12 legions of angels and wipe all you guys out? He could have done that, but he didn't. He let God deal with it. You know, Peter references this in 1 Peter 2:23. Says, when they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. You know, being humble, being submissive in a conflict, it really is a matter of faith. Do you entrust yourself to God? Do you trust God? You know, and I don't say this lightly. This could be a deep or difficult question for some of us. Because maybe we feel like we have been hurt. Maybe we feel like there has been injustice in our lives or in others' lives. And it's a really deep and difficult question to say, do I really trust God? And can I really entrust myself to him? Do you trust that God will handle things? That God will deal with it? You know, and I think what I see in myself, and maybe for you as well, that perhaps when I want to control things, when I want to control others, I want to control outcomes, and I want to engage in disputes that I shouldn't, it points back to struggling to really entrust myself to God. Saying, God's got this. Entrust yourself to one who judges justly. You know, in Hebrews 10, talks more about this in verse 30. It says, for we know him who said, it is mine to avenge. I will repay. And again, the Lord will judge his people. It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Remember those earlier days after you had received the light when you endured a great conflict full of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You know, the early Christians, they endured a great suffering. A great conflict full of suffering. They were publicly exposed to insult. They were persecuted. They saw it happening to their friends. It says they suffered with those that were in prison. People were thrown in prison for their faith, and they suffered. They had their property confiscated. You know, we read these depictions, and I hope and pray that we never experience these things in our world, but it could happen. But I don't feel like we're there. You know, we get upset that somebody posted a meme we didn't like, or they disagree with us, or they say something that hurts our feelings, they weren't sensitive enough, and I'm not minimizing those things, but man, even them, even with what they were going through, it says they trusted in God. It says they knew they had better and lasting possessions. You know, we talked about that in the treasure principle a few weeks back, that our hope and our treasure is not in this life. We've got treasure that's being stored up in heaven. And these early Christians, they focused on what really mattered. They put the main thing as the main thing. Brothers and sisters, God is going to take care of you. God has your back. Do you believe that? Are you confident in God? He says your confidence will be richly rewarded. Let us let Jesus fight our battles. Let God deal with those who wrong you. Because you know what? We live in a world of conflict and strife. It's always been that way since Adam and Eve in the garden, and it's always going to be that way until Jesus comes back. There's a place and a time that it won't be. That's called heaven. We'll get there, right? So how can we get along with just about anyone? You know, this week we talked about a lot of ways to avoid conflicts, okay? And that's a good start. How to not stir up more conflicts. A good way to get along is these three keys here. Mind your business, let it go, and if that doesn't work, let God deal with it, right? But there are times when we must engage. There are times when the conflict is within our circle of control or maybe in our circle of influence, and we can't just let it go. And so next week, we're going to jump even deeper into this and talk about, okay, when we're in those conflicts, when we're in situations that we have to deal with, how can we do it in a righteous, godly, productive, healthy way? So for today, remember, three things. How to get along with just about anyone. Mind your business. Let it go. Let God deal with it. And to God be the glory. Thank you.
Amen, church. Before we close with one final song, we're going to have a prayer. Lord, thank you so much for the things that Tim shared with us today, for the word that he shared for you.